Before we get started, I want to say a few words. One, to say how much I have enjoyed working with and getting to know you guys over the last term. One of the advantages for me of teaching both terms of this course is that I do get to know people a little bit more, and I have truly enjoyed that. I didn't get to know every one of you individually, of course, but many of you I have gotten to know, and I've really enjoyed and appreciated those interactions. I've also appreciated your interactions as a class. Coming back from sabbatical after a year, I found I was a little rustier than I usually have been, and you guys have been very patient with that, and I very much appreciated that. And the fact that we've used a new book this year and found some errors and so forth as we've gone through that, again, you guys have been great to work with and patient with all that. So I hope that you've learned a lot this term, and you've learned a lot last term as well. I also certainly wish you all the very best as you're moving forward in your careers. I'm always happy to help you as I can going along, whether that's with advice or that's with, in some cases, I've talked to several of you already for like interview practice and things like that. I do those sorts of things with students, so if that's of interest to you, let me know. And of course, if I've gotten to know you through letters of reference as well. So I'm always happy to help you with those things. So again, thank you so much. It's been a wonderful, wonderful year working with all of you. I really have enjoyed that. As I said last time, before I dive into the stuff, I have scheduled a review session. The review session will be Monday night at 7 p.m. in ALS 4001, where all the other ones have been. And I will videotape it as always. So we have fortunately not had any problems with videotaping this year. The only problem I had was I had one where I forgot to turn the microphone on. But fortunately, I always carry a backup recording with me, so I was able to use the backup recording to make that work. So we haven't lost anything, which is good. Okay, so as I said last time, I'm not going to go through new material today. We've covered all the material in the course. So what I'm going to do is start the overview process. I don't think we're probably going to finish the overview in this one-hour session. But if we do, great. I also have a fun song at the end, and to your surprise or maybe dismay, it's actually longer than the one last time. So, yeah, the one last time was a lot of fun. I love to sing. The one today I can't sing very well, but I'm going to give it a shot, and hopefully you guys will help me to do that as well. Okay, well, I looked back at what I had covered in the last overview, and I believe I covered in the last overview up through DNA replication, repair, recombination. So starting with this overview, I'm starting with transcription, and I'm just going to talk about this in fairly general terms, obviously. Now, as you've seen with the other overviews, I don't mean for these overviews to be comprehensive, certainly. They are, as I see them, as I'm going through the list, talking about stuff. And as always, if you have questions or you want clarification, please feel free to pipe up and say something. Okay. So, central dogma, we've said enough about that. We had a song about it last time. If you didn't learn it from that, I'm probably not going to get you to learn it at this point. We've seen this term about the process of transcription and the real central role that transcription plays in the control of gene expression. The gene expression, of course, is that function that's on the left making protein. And how much protein we make really is a critical thing for a cell. Cell doesn't want to make too much, but it wants to have it it wants to have it available when it is needed. And so that balance is necessary control. One of the things that helps to control that is also a product of transcription, and those are the non-coding RNAs that you see on the right. And I've talked about silencing RNAs, which are a group of the non-coding RNAs that are there. And the silencing RNAs play roles in helping to control how much protein is actually made. You know that the building blocks of RNA, of course, are the nucleotides, ATP, GTP, UTP, and CTP. And over the past two terms, you have seen how those things all play into the metabolic processes of the cell, contributing energy for various purposes. Relevant to the material in this term, we've talked about primarily GTP, actually, as energy source for the process of translation. And of course, all four of these are necessary for the process of transcription. I talked about at length about how eukaryotic transcription is more complex than prokaryotic transcription is. Eukaryotic transcription is spatially separated from translation by virtue of the fact that there's a nucleus, and transcription occurs in the nucleus of eukaryotic cells. Translation occurs in the cytoplasm. And we've also seen how eukaryotic RNAs are processed considerably different than prokaryotic ones, particularly the messenger RNAs. So the messenger RNAs in prokaryotic cells are translated almost as soon as they are being synthesized. So we have both of those processes going on at once. Whereas in eukaryotic cells, we have the messenger RNA being made, and then there's a processing of it that occurs before it is finally translated. That process, includes things like putting a 5' cap on it, putting a 3' a poly A tail on it, and in most cases, splicing of sequences in the middle. So all three of those happen to eukaryotic messenger RNAs, and all three of them are necessary for translation of those eukaryotic messenger RNAs. Transcription, you should remember, proceeds only in the 5' to 3' direction, and only one of the strands is copied. So the strand that is copied is known as the template strand of the DNA, and the other strand that's complementary to the template strand is known as the coding strand. So there is a distinction between those. You saw that transcription was controlled through promoters, and promoters are sequences that are recognized either by an RNA polymerase, as happens in prokaryotic cells, or by transcription factors that bind to that sequence, as found in eukaryotic cells. If we examine sequences, and these are all shown here in case of a prokaryotic cell, if we examine sequences near the transcriptional start site, where the transcriptional start site is labeled as +1, we see that there are a couple of regions of conserved sequences in prokaryotic cells, one called a -10 sequence that is AT-rich, and that AT-richness facilitates the unwinding or the opening of the two strands, and a -35 sequence that is not quite so AT-rich that is also important in that process. And I've shown you a schematic figure showing how the RNA polymerase sets down on top of both of those sequences. And it looks like something like this, where the RNAP is the RNA polymerase. In prokaryotic cells, the binding of the promoter sequences is relatively simple, and it's facilitated by one of the subunit proteins of the RNA polymerase known as the sigma factor. So the sigma factor is a subunit protein of the RNA polymerase. It is specific for binding sequences in this area. And I noted, and I didn't say too much about it, but I did note that there were different sigma factors that were made under different conditions in the cell. The example I gave in class was that of heat shock. And during heat shock, different sets of sigma factors are made. And if different sigma factors have different sequences that they recognize and bind to, then we could imagine that the transcriptional pattern of a cell would change depending upon what sigma factors are being made. And that's actually very much akin to what happens in eukaryotic cells when we think about tissue-specific expression. So in tissue-specific expression, we have certain proteins, transcriptional activators, that are made in one tissue but not made in another. And those transcriptional activators bind to enhancer sequences and facilitate transcription of genes adjacent to them. So if a transcriptional activator is being made in a skin cell and not being made in a bone cell, then a particular gene the enhancer next to a particular gene that transcriptional activator recognizes will be bound by that transcriptional activator, and synthesis, a transcription of that gene will occur, say, in a skin cell, but not in a bone cell. So that's really sort of a parallel with the sigma factor, the difference being that enhancers are variable regions away from the start of a gene, and there's more complexity about that, as I'll talk about in just a bit. Okay, transcription proceeds through the movement of an RNA polymerase essentially between the strands, kind of like you see here, forming what we call a transcriptional bubble. You see the RNA polymerase hanging off the end, and of course transcription starts at the 5' end, and it's the 5' end that will hang off of here. The sigma factor is released very soon after the transcription starts, within the first 10 nucleotides or so. Yes, question? Did I hear a question? Oh, bless you. Oh, they said question. Okay, yeah, good. Somebody's got a question, but bless you as well. Okay. The elongation, so I broke transcription down into initiation, elongation, and termination. And elongation is not a very exciting process, but it's a very important process because without it, we don't have messenger RNAs that are being made. The process of transcriptional termination in prokaryotic cells is a little bit more interesting. I mentioned two different ways in which termination can occur in prokaryotic cells, one being through what's called factor-independent termination and one that involves factor-dependent termination. When I showed you these two on the same screen, we see a factor-independent termination that involves formation of a specific hairpin loop. And I emphasize that specific because, again, many times students think that any hairpin loop will do that, and that's not the case. But a specific hairpin loop that forms in the RNA as the RNA is being synthesized. And when it forms, it causes the what I call the butt end of the RNA polymerase to be literally lifted up, and it's the lifting up of that RNA polymerase off of the DNA that causes the entire complex to fall apart, and the messenger RNA being made falls out as well. You notice that adjacent to the hairpin structure that there is, in fact, an AU-rich sequence, and that also falls apart relatively easily so that the messenger RNA can be released. Factor-dependent termination of transcription occurs through a protein called Rho, which I described as climbing up the 5' end of the messenger RNA, and ultimately catching the RNA polymerase. The RNA polymerase slows down when it hits GC-rich sequences, and so when it hits those GC-rich sequences, the Rho has a chance to catch it, to grab it, and cause everything to fall apart as well. I talked about chromosomal structure, probably ad nauseum, with respect to histones and the wrapping of DNAs around those histones. I mentioned that the histones come in four different groups that make up an octamer, H2A, H2B, H3, and H4. And it's around that octamer, that's the blue ball that we see here, that the DNA is wrapped. That wrapping of a blue ball of the octamer core of histones by DNA forms what we call a nucleosome. And the nucleosome is the sort of fundamental unit of chromatin. Because there's chromatin, of course, eukaryotic cells have got to unwind that to provide access to the transcriptional machinery so that transcription can occur. I also mentioned histone H1, which is not part of the octamer core, but in fact, as you can see, is on the outside, and it sort of facilitates holding this down. I like to think about this if you've ever made ribbons for a Christmas package. You go to tie it, somebody's got to hold it down while you do all the little cool twirly things. That's what the H1's doing. Yes, sir? So the beads on the string are what you get when you sort of loosen up the chromatin structure. So chromatin is a very broad term that encompasses the compact, the loose, everything. So chromatin is all of those things, okay? But the beads on a string you can form by loosening that up, okay? Yes? So we only see chromatin structures and histones in eukaryotic cells. In recent years, people have identified what appear to be sort of primitive complexes like that in prokaryotic cells. They're not nearly as well characterized, and they're probably not nearly as elaborate as they are in eukaryotic cells. So we still sort of speak about prokaryotic DNAs as being naked, although they probably aren't completely devoid of protein. Yes? Yes? Okay, so the question related to the factor independent, is it this one? No, it's not that one, that's the hairpin. Okay, so is this a protein up here? The answer is no, okay? So this is just me using color to highlight that actual structure and point that out to people, okay? Yeah, yeah. Only in prokaryotic, yes, right. So termination and eukaryotic I haven't talked about, and that's a more complex system for doing that, as you might imagine. Okay, let's see. Control sequences in eukaryotic cells. I mentioned that there were quite a variety of them. I don't expect you're going to memorize those, but I do think you should know that there is an equivalent to the minus 10 sequence in prokaryotic cells. In eukaryotic cells, is known as a Tata box. And the Tata box is, located is located a variable distance away from the transcriptional start site, typically between about 25 and 100 nucleotides away from the transcriptional start site. Okay. Let's see, what else? This is what the complex looks like for transcription for most eukaryotic genes. It involves binding of a variety of these factors, and I said I didn't expect you to memorize those, but of course you need to know the RNA polymerase. You should know RNA polymerase 2, of course, is the one that's involved in messenger RNA. RNA polymerase 1 is involved with the ribosomal RNAs, and the RNA polymerase 3 is involved with the transfer RNAs and smaller RNAs. But I also said the other factor you should know here is called TF2D, which stands for transcription factor 2D. That's actually the first one that binds to help the overall complex to assemble. And the TF2D itself contains another polypeptide within it called the Tata binding protein, or the TBD, that's a part of that. And that's actually the part that binds to the Tata box. Okay, factors, blah, blah, blah. There's the TBP, as it's labeled here, Tata binding protein, or Tata binding, I can't think what the D stands for, but in any event, there's a protein that binds the Tata box. Alpha, talked about alpha manantin being the poison of poisonous mushrooms, and it's poisonous because it's a very potent inhibitor of eukaryotic RNA polymerase 3. That shows the 5' cap, which I said protected the messenger RNA from nuclease attack, and I said it also played a role in the process of translation. The other things that happen is at the 3' end, there's a poly-A tail that is placed onto the end of it, and that too plays a role both in protection and in the efficiency of translation. Yes, sir? Oh, I'm sorry. So alpha amanitin inhibits RNA polymerase 2. Did I say 3? I'm sorry, I meant 2. It actually inhibits all 3, but the one that's the most sensitive to it is RNA polymerase 2. And RNA polymerase 2 is exquisitely sensitive to it. Yeah, sorry for confusion on that. It's RNA polymerase 2 is the primary one that's affected. Okay, splicing, removing of intervening sequences known as introns, and the joining of the pieces that remain creates the exons joined together to make a final messenger RNA. I noted that splicing can occur in other RNAs besides messenger RNAs, so it also occurs in ribosomal RNAs and also in transfer RNAs, although mostly we talk about it with respect to messenger RNAs. The mechanism that's involved involves some of the conserved sequences we see in introns. Introns have a conserved GU at the 5' end, an AG at the 3' end, and an A embedded in a polypyrimidine sequence about 30 nucleotides away from the end. During the process of splicing, this G of the 5' end attacks the A and makes a unique 2' to 5' bond that creates a lasso structure. And the upshot of this is the two exons get joined together and the intron splits out as a lasso. The structure in the cell that makes that is known as a spliceosome. And the spliceosome is a complex of proteins and RNAs that I drew the analogy to a ribosome. It might be not quite the same thing, but they are both complexes of RNAs and proteins that do things inside of the cell. Splicing allows a cell to mix and match exons and make gigantic combinations of numbers of different sequences as a result of that mixing and matching. And that is important for diversity of proteins in eukaryotic cells, because eukaryotic cells only have about 20,000 different proteins that they code for, but the mixing and matching of those may bring it up to close to 200,000 different forms of those proteins that are available. Let's see, what else did I want to say? Transfer RNA structure. Looks like a clover leaf in 2 dimensions. and excuse me, in three dimensions, it folds over, looks a little bit different from that. Processing of tRNA, somebody asked me a question from class about that last night. The processing of transfer RNAs, this is primarily in prokaryotes, happens as coming from a larger, this is eukaryotes, but the prokaryotes also have a larger sequence that both transfer RNAs and ribosomal RNAs are made on a single transcript, and those are actually cleaved out of that. There are also transfer RNAs that are made independently of these bigger structures that you see here. Okay, let's see. I showed you how these guys can have enormous numbers of base pairing and secondary structures that can arise. Okay, so I've talked 20 minutes on one lecture. I better speed up, Ahern. Okay. Oh, no, actually, that was two plus, wasn't it? Okay. All right, so moving to the process of translation. Of course, translation is the synthesis of protein using information in the genetic code. In the genetic code, we have three base sequences called codons that are found in the messenger RNA. And those three base codons specify amino acids. I said that there was redundancy in the amino acids, in the genetic code, such that most amino acids are coded for by more than one codon. And the places where those sequences differ are primarily in the third position, which I called the wobble position. And if we look, for example, at, let's say, leucine, leucine is specified by CUX, where the fourth base is any base of those of the four that are possible. And I pointed out that there are 64 possible codons. And of those 64 possible codons, there are four that are used as punctuation marks. The AUG is always the start, although on rare cases, GUG is actually used to start. But the AUG is the start. And there are three codons used as stop codons, known as UAA, UAG, and UGA. There are only two codons that are unique, that is, that are specified uniquely for amino acid. A methionine is one, and we see methionine, it can only be specified by AUG, and tryptophan is the other, and it is, I can't remember what it's specified by, but it's up there somewhere. Yeah, it's UGG, okay. So those two amino acids are the only ones that are specified by a single codon. You don't need to know that last thing, by the way, just an observation. Ribosomes translate the genetic code. They have a large subunit and a small subunit. Those two assemble on the messenger RNA and then move three bases at a time down the messenger RNA, incorporating amino acids into a growing polypeptide chain. Ribosomes have, as I said, a large subunit and a small subunit. We see that they have three sites for binding transfer RNAs, and that constitutes an A site, a P site, and an E site. With the exception of the very first transfer RNA that codes for methionine, all of the transfer RNAs carrying amino acids come in on the A site. The first one with AUG and methionine starts in the P site. And as the ribosome moves from left to right, the transfer RNAs move or don't move. In essence, they sort of slide through these sites, exiting out through the E site as things progress. The large ribosomal subunit is where the 23S ribosomal RNA is found in prokaryotic cells, and that's the part of the ribosome that actually catalyzes the formation of the peptide bonds. Transfer RNAs, of course, are the things that essentially where the genetic code is translated. That's what a transfer RNA does, because one end has an amino acid and the other end has an anticodon that is complementary to the codon in the messenger RNA. So there are enzymes known as aminoacyl tRNA synthetases that recognize transfer RNAs and know which amino acid to put on this end to match the anticodon down here. The amino acids get put onto what I described as either the 2' prime or the 3' prime end of the transfer RNA. And those linkages of those amino acids vary from one transfer RNA to another. There are what I call type 1 aminoacyl tRNA synthetases that put the amino acid on the 2' prime end, and type 2 aminoacyl tRNA synthetases that put it on the 3' prime end. there's a structure of that, what's shown as the 3' end here. Of course, the 2' end is the same end as the 3' end. Okay, the putting on or the attachment of the amino acid to the tRNA is known as, it's called charging the tRNA. So you're charging the tRNA by covalently attaching an amino acid to its end. I noted that the attachment of the amino acid at the 2 or 3' end of the transfer RNA is very labile in water with a half-life of about a second or so. So cells have a protein that protects the bond between the two from water so that water can't come and hydrolyze it. In E. coli, that protein is known as EFTU and is the most abundant protein that's found in E. coli. EFTU plays roles in translation that include bringing the transfer RNA to the ribosome for translation and ensuring that the proper complementarity is found between the anticodon and the codon. And I'll say just a brief word about that as well in a bit. There's the charging. Charging takes a fair amount of energy. So you produce AMP when the charging occurs, which means that you're making the equivalent of two ATPs to put that amino acid onto the end of a transfer RNA. Bacterial cells use not methionine to start translation, but a modified form of it known as formylmethionine, or N-formylmethionine, as some people call it. And that involves the attachment right here that you can see of this formyl group on the end. And this occurs after the messenger, after the methionine has been attached to the transfer RNA. So it's kind of like what I talked about on Wednesday with respect to selenocysteine, which is made on a transfer RNA. Okay, let's see, the wobble position has an interesting feature about it, and that is that the wobble position within a transfer RNA commonly has the nucleotide inosine, corresponding to the base hypoxanthine, as you can see here. And inosine can form stable base pairs with three of the nucleotides, which means that cells don't have to make as many transfer RNAs code and pair properly in the ribosome. The ribosome, as I said, has a large subunit and a small subunit. The small subunit shown there, and the large subunit shown down here. Yeah. Yeah, oh, I'm sorry. I'm just a little. So inosinate simply means it's the ionized form, okay? So like formates, the ionized form of formic acid, for example, inosine is correctly called inosinic acid, and so when you ionize it, it's inosinate. But I use the terms interchangeably, so don't worry about that, okay? Okay, so we have a large subunit, a small subunit. The small subunit in bacterial cells contains the 16S ribosomal RNA. And that's the part of the ribosomal RNA that contained the Shine-Delgarno sequence that I talked about. You can see there's 21 proteins found in the small subunit, which is called the 30S subunit. The S referring to Swedberg units, which are a measure of size, as I noted in class. The large subunit in prokaryotic cells contains two ribosomal RNAs, the 5S ribosomal RNA and the 23S. And it's the 23S that is the catalyst for making the peptide bonds. It is a ribozyme since it's an RNA that catalyzes a reaction. Summary of all the ribosomal RNAs there. Eukaryotic cells have larger ones in general, but eukaryotic cells also contain a unique one known as the 5.8S ribosomal RNA. It's not found in prokaryotic cells. The 5.8S is also found in the large subunit in eukaryotic cells. I mostly talked about the process occurring in prokaryotic cells. You can see it occurring here, the incoming transfer RNA carrying the amino acid, and the complementarity of the anticodon in the transfer RNA with the codon in the messenger RNA. As I noted, that the EFTU is responsible for most of this process right here. EFTU brings in the transfer RNA, checks to see if there's proper pairing. And if it is, then it hydrolyzes GTP and gets out of there. If it does not see proper pairing, it means that the wrong transfer RNA is in the A site, which is where it comes in. and then it removes it, and another one is allowed to come in. I noted that the process of translation occurs at about 15 to 20 amino acids per second, which roughly corresponds to the rate of transcription in prokaryotic cells, which is about 45 to 60 base pairs or bases per second. Let's see, elongation there, didn't really show you that figure. EFTU is the most abundant protein in E. coli, as I noted, and it's protecting the transfer RNA against hydrolysis of the amino acid attached to it by water. In eukaryotic, in prokaryotic cells, I talked about the Shine-Dalgarno sequence, which I think, no, where's the Shine-Dalgarno? Here it is. The Shine-Dalgarno sequence is right there. The Shine-Dalgarno sequence is a sequence found roughly 10 nucleotides away from the start codon in prokaryotic cells. It is complementary to the sequence in the 16S ribosomal RNA. And during the process of initiation, the first thing that happens is the 16S RNA, the small ribosomal subunit carrying the 16S ribosomal RNA binds to the messenger RNA, and these sequences align. So it's the alignment of the base pairing between the Shine-Dalgarno sequence in the 16S ribosomal RNA and this sequence in the messenger RNA that aligns where that start codon is in the what will become the ribosome. After that has occurred, then the large subunit comes and binds and forms that ribosomal complex, and then the initiator tRNA comes in and everything gets started. Okay. Blah, blah. Okay, in the process of termination, what happens is that a stop codon appears in the A site of the ribosome. There is no complementary tRNA that allows that to come in and allows translation to continue, so the ribosome pauses at that point. And release factors come in, release factors carrying a molecule of water that it donates to that tRNA amino acid complex and causes hydrolysis to occur so that the polypeptide attached to that tRNA is released and the entire complex falls apart. Okay. In eukaryotic cells, the process overall is rather similar. There are some differences. We don't have a Shine-Dalgarno sequence. But there do appear to be some conservation of sequences around the initiator AUG. And you can see that here. Those sequences that are conserved are called COSAC sequences, as you can see on this slide. They're not quite as conserved as a Shine-Dalgarno sequence is, however. Messenger RNAs, as I noted, have a 5' cap and a 3' poly A tail. And this figure shows how a variety of initiation factors, and I'm not sure I pointed out in class, but I'll point it out here. IF stands for initiation factor. So a variety of initiation factors help this overall complex to form. The messenger RNA forms a bit of a circle-like structure that may help to facilitate additional translation after the first round of translation has been completed. Okay. I talked about membrane proteins and how they are made in the endoplasmic reticulum, and they get targeted there by a signal peptide that is made at the amino end of a protein as it is being synthesized. That signal peptide is bound by a signal recognition particle, the SRP, and the binding of that ultimately results in the dragging of the ribosome complex to the membrane of the endoplasmic reticulum. And from there, the process of translation proceeds, ultimately with the signal sequence being clipped off and then the protein itself either being embedded in the membrane, like you can see here, or being processed inside of the lumen of the endoplasmic reticulum. And then it has other destinations that it may have as a result of sequences contained within that protein. Okay, how am I doing time-wise? Okay, that's not too bad. Gene expression was the next topic that I talked about. And gene expression, of course, was important for how it is that our levels of individual proteins are made or not made, as the case may be. I talked first about what I described as the best characterized system known as the lac operon in E. coli. The lac operon has a relatively simple scheme for controlling transcription. It includes sequences that are bound by three different proteins. One protein being what's called the lac repressor, which binds up here on the far right. The RNA polymerase binding site, which is where the promoter region is located. And then finally, a protein called CAP that binds 5' ahead of everything else up there. The lac repressor is the key one in this overall scheme because the lac repressor, if it binds, completely turns off transcription. The lac repressor binds when lactose is not present in cells. When lactose is present in cells, the lac repressor has a binding site for it, and it binds lactose and then cannot bind the operator, that's called the operator sequence here, cannot bind the operator. And when that happens, then the promoter is left completely open for the RNA polymerase to bind and transcription to start. When the repressor is bound, you notice that they overlap sequences there, the RNA polymerase simply cannot bind. The CAP protein binds to the molecule cyclic AMP, and cyclic AMP is produced when cells are needing energy. So when cells are needing energy, they're making cyclic AMP, and when lactose is available, the lac repressor isn't there. So when that happens, the CAP binds to cyclic AMP, and that facilitates its binding to this region up here. That also facilitates the binding of the RNA polymerase to the promoter, because this is not a very strong promoter, as I noted. So that the CAP actually helps it to bind. And when these two come together and start binding, a lot of transcription occurs. If you didn't have the CAP binding to cyclic AMP, you would only get a relatively small amount of transcription actually occurring. Okay. Let's see, what else here? I talked about polycistronic messages. Bacterial cells have multiple proteins contained on a single messenger RNA. In the case of the lac operon, and by the way, an operon is a DNA that codes for those multiple proteins. So the lac operon contains coding for three different proteins. What was I going to say? Lost my train of thought. The individual genes within the lac operon are the LacZ, which is the beta-galactosidase that actually breaks down lactose. That's the most critical one that I talked about. And then the other two, whose importance you don't really need to know, but I'll tell you, permease that allows the movement of lactose in easily, and a molecule called transacetylase that actually is the active form of the molecule that binds to the lac repressor. So I just slipped into it here, and people frequently do this. They'll talk about lactose being bound by the repressor, but it's actually a modified form of lactose that binds to the lac repressor known as allolactose. For our purposes, if you said lactose bound to the lac repressor, I would be happy. Okay. So understanding that and the relationship between the binding and whether or not transcription occurs is a very important consideration. Okay. Let's see, what else did I talk about? Riboswitches. Oh, I'm sorry, tryptophan operon. Tryptophan operon has two schemes. The simple one is very much like the lac operon, except for, in this case, the binding of tryptophan to lac repressor actually occurs when tryptophan is present, not when the molecule is absent. So the binding of tryptophan to the repressor causes it to bind the operator sequence and stops transcription of the tryptophan operon. The tryptophan operon is also regulated by a process I described as attenuation. Attenuation is shown in this figure, in which the ribosome is proceeding along the messenger RNA. The RNA polymerase is working up ahead doing the translation. If the ribosome is moving relatively rapidly, we have the situation that occurs, as you can see on the top. It covers up, it rapidly moves along, it uses tryptophan, and it covers up region 2. When region 2 gets covered up like this, regions 3 and 4 form a transcriptional terminator, and the RNA polymerase is kicked off. On the other hand, when tryptophan levels in the cell are low, the ribosome does not move so fast. It's translating a sequence that has tryptophan codons in there, and so it waits for a transfer RNA carrying tryptophan to arrive. When that happens, region 2 is left exposed, and region 2 can base pair with region 3. Well, the difference here is that this molecule, first of all, will not terminate transcription, and by forming in this way, 3 cannot base pair with 4, so that the thing that would form the transcriptional terminator can't form, and as a consequence, the RNA polymerase continues along its way. So when tryptophan levels are low, the synthesis of the entire messenger RNA occurs. When the tryptophan levels are high, transcription terminates prematurely. Okay. All right, let's see. I talked about riboswitches. Riboswitches are things that, they're basically three-dimensional RNA structures that can bind molecules. And when they bind molecules, they change their shape. Not unlike a protein binding an allosteric effector. When they change their shape, they may signal or cause something to happen with respect to transcription. And in this case, the binding of the riboswitch here is causing the terminator sequence to form, whereas when there's no molecule binding, the terminator sequence does not form. And so in this case, we could turn off transcription. In this case, we wouldn't turn off transcription. Two regions identified in terms of names, the aptamer binding domain is where the molecule binds, and the switching sequence is the part that is flipping as a result of that binding. I didn't talk about the expression platform, and I'm not going to expect you to know that either. Okay. Let's see. Talked about eukaryotes, and of course, again, the complexity of transcription there. I talked a little bit more detail about the structure of the chromatin and pointed out that as you started from the left and you started zooming in, you would see various structures as we see here, ultimately getting on the second from the right to the nucleosome, which is what we see in this complex shown there. The nucleosome, as I said, being the fundamental unit of chromatin. Histones, H2A, H2B, H3, and H4 are very conserved throughout eukaryotes. Being very similar in structure and sequence between yeast all the way up to human beings. So it says a lot about the importance of their function. Where am I at here? I've shown you that before. I'm not going to repeat that. I talked about epigenetics, and epigenetics was a phenomenon I described where information is being transmitted across generations without it being encoded in the nucleic acid. And I pointed out some various ways in which that can happen. One way in which that can happen is through modification of the histones themselves. And I showed a variety of chemical modifications that can happen to histones. And I also talked about how the DNA itself could be chemically modified by putting methyl groups onto cytosines. And those cytosines that it goes onto are called CpG sequences. Now, those modifications, whether they are histone in nature or they are DNA in nature, are in fact transmitted through germ cells across generations. And so the progeny that get those modified histones and modified DNAs retain those modifications for a period of time. And so it's through that process that we can see across generations effects that happen. I talked about how starvation, for example, could be transmitted all the way to grandchildren from grandparents who had experienced conditions of starvation. And it's happening through those chemical modifications. The most common chemical modifications are methylations and acetylations that happen. And I talked specifically about acetylations because acetylations, we know, are, that's a methylation there. Acetylations are involved in, I'm trying to find my figure. I'm not sure if I talked about that in class, but I kind of like this. The tails are the things that primarily get modified off the histones. And look at that. Look at the number of different modifications that can happen on those tails. It's just amazing to think about the complexity and each one of those modifications having some specific effect on the gene, the expression of the gene that's attached to that. Okay. There we go. I talked about the acetylations and how the acetylations help the in certain places on the histones help the chromatin complex to relax, and it's the relaxing of that complex that opens the structure up so that transcription can occur. If we have the relaxed form, we have a form of chromatin called euchromatin, and that form is transcriptionally active. If we have the tightly bound form, we have heterochromatin, and that's where we have the phenomenon of gene silencing occur, where we don't have as much gene expression going on. Acetylation is catalyzed by enzymes called acetylases, no surprise there, and that acetylation modifies lysine side chains of the histones, causing them to change from being positively charged to being more neutrally charged, and that results in the loosening that I described because the DNA is negatively charged. The removal of the acetyl groups from the lysines is a function of enzymes called histone deacetylases, or HDACs. And HDACs, example I gave was sirtuins, which may have some role in longevity. And so that's a very interesting phenomenon that's being studied actively now. Different modifications, I listed a bunch of them there for you to see. And that was what I talked about with respect to epigenetics. Okay. Enhancers, of course, are sequences in eukaryotic cells that are located a variable region away from the transcriptional start site, and they function by the mechanism I showed here, where we have transcriptional activators that bind to the enhancer, and through a bending of the DNA, they're brought into close proximity of the promoter and help facilitate the assembly of the transcriptional complex that causes transcription to begin. I showed, I showed in this complex a couple of things. One, this was an enhancer bound by transcriptional activators. We could see the promoter complex being assembled here. And I also noted that there were insulator or silencer sequences, and they're both called the same thing, that can turn off or have the negative effect of an enhancer. That is, they can inhibit the construction of a transcriptional complex. So which one is more active depends, again, on the tissue, which tissues have the individual proteins that are being made there, and which ones get to the promoter first, essentially. Okay, that, I think, is enough for today. So I will finish the overview when I start the review session on Monday night. I hope that you, as one last thing, will join me singing loudly a very difficult song to sing. I know that's a challenge. It's called My A. And now the course is done, except for all that final testing. Dear friends, let's have some fun. There surely won't be much protesting. We've had a busy term, addressing all the content swiftly. And so I sit and squirm, BB350. Written for a different class, obviously. Exams, there's been a few. Our averages were somewhat lower. The grades were all askew. I wish that Ahern would go slower. I studied hard each time, and even though my grades were iffy, oh no, I did not whine, BB350. Yes, it was tough, you knew it too. I memorized, my knowledge grew, and through it all I did not frown. I thought it up and wrote it down. I fought the fight, I hope it's right, BB350. I laughed, I cried, I swore, just as I did here on the first day. But since the term is o'er, let's all go out for Thirsty Thursday. I guess I have to face the fact that I am not a Swifty, but oh, I need to ace BB350. The end arrives, our grades are out, as I log in to my account. I say some things I truly feel. I hope I don't have to appeal. There's no dismay. I made my A. BB350. All right, guys. Thank you all very much. Thank you.